Why not solar now? Next on Enviro Close Up. Welcome to Enviro Close Up. I am Carl Grossman. Why not solar now? The technology for solar power is here today. Why isn't it being made use of widely in the United States, indeed around the world? With me are two experts, two practitioners, two people from the solar industry who work in it every day. Jim Newberry is with the Earth Star Energy Systems of Waldboro, Maine.
Waldboro.
And the specialty of Earth Star, well, mostly thermal solar, or hot water heating, and so forth. Richard Gottlieb is Sunnyside Solar. They're in Brattleboro, Vermont. And the specialty of Sunnyside Solar is solar photovoltaic, those panels that directly convert sunlight into electric power. Jim, why isn't solar being taken advantage of as it should be in the 1990s?
It's a big question, an important one. There are a lot of different viewpoints on that question. From my personal perspective, it's a matter of our federal policies, which are, from my study of the situation, are primarily subsidizing the conventional, as we call it, energy sources of the fossil fuels, coal, oil, gas, and the fission atomic power.
Now, under Reagan, under Bush, you know, I suppose we kind of could have expected that. Indeed, one of the first things that President Reagan did when he was elected in 1980 was literally have the solar panels on the White House ripped off.
That's right.
And then we saw very, very heavy pro-nuclear, pro-coal, pro-oil policies. Mm-hmm. And it happened through the Bush administration. But now it's the 1990s. Reagan and Bush are out of office. What will it take to kind of shake up the U.S. Department of Energy? Hazel O'Leary et al., what will it take to shake up the White House so solar is pushed, as it was pushed, in fact, under the Carter administration?
Well, these questions of where we derive our energy resources from are very, very important to our nation, but you can't turn on and off solar like a light switch. The buildup of our conventional sources, the commitment, the financial commitment we've made to the fossil and nuclear industry is large, and to abandon that, for example, would create some economic havoc in the utility industry and the stock market, for example. So it's very tough to go against the special interests who have already developed much of our energy production capability and start changing. A lot of the problem, of course, is political in Washington, because our government is so influenced by the powerful special interests, which primarily do represent the interests of centralized production, energy production technologies such as atomic fission plants or oil.
Now, Richard, you're very active in Brattleboro, Vermont. What do you sense is the attitude of most people in terms of solar power? Do you find a real desire for it?
Everyone is pro-solar. I don't talk to anyone that isn't for solar energy and for buying. The difficulty is the upfront investment is high, and it's difficult to justify, particularly solar electricity, if you're already on the power grid. The production of electricity from photovoltaics is expensive. Right now, it's an overseas market, and it's a niche market in the United States, which is basically revolves around people that are off the power lines to the tune of a mile or so. When the hookup charge is $25,000, the line extension, which used to be subsidized by the Rural Electrification Commission, when the hookup charge is like $25,000 to $30,000, it's an easy decision for people to make to apply photovoltaics to that living situation.
The advances in photovoltaics dramatic in recent years. Can you describe some of the hookups Sunnyside has made?
Well, the advances, as you say, are dramatic. Things have improved vastly in the 10 years or so that we've been in business. Mainly, electronic inverters have improved vastly, the control equipment, UL listing of equipment and modules and all that. And the price of various things has come down drastically in the last 10 years. We used to have to pay $8 and $10 a watt for equipment. Now we're paying $4 and $5 a watt for equipment, for modules. The kind of work that we've done has been multifaceted. We do a lot of work for the state of Massachusetts. We've done work for the Metropolitan District Commission. We recently put a large system on Pettix Island in Boston Harbor. We've done some work at the Quabbin Reservoir at remote forest headquarters and things like that. And the backbone of our work has been dealing with people in remote situations where there is no electricity. We've done hundreds and hundreds of systems for people that are without the benefit of the power line.
Jim, your company doesn't specialize in photovoltaics, but you specialize in people being able to get hot water, not from an oil burner down in the basement, but from the heat of the sun. Describe some of your work in recent years.
Well, we are a distributor and design firm, and we sell equipment that's based on our designs, and one of our specialties is hydronic radiant floor heating systems. Mm. This is using a synthetic type of tubing that's embedded in a floor, whether it's a poured floor like a slab or a wooden floor, and circulating warm water through it for your heating system. Not only is it efficient, but it's also very easy to use solar hot water heating with that because it's low temperature heat.
Now, in the 60s, even with the great incentives, the tax credit offered by the Carter administration, some of the systems used for solar hot water were, well, they leaked and there were some problems. Have similar strides been made in solar hot water as have been made in photovoltaic?
That's a good question. I believe that some advances have been made. The workhorse in the industry, as far as the solar collector, has remained fairly much the same. And one attribute of the solar industry is the fact that the price has remained relatively stable over the past decade. But the workhorse is your typical flat plate solar collector. Some advances in the collector and in the systems, what type of tubing and such you used to hook up between your storage tank and your collector and the controls and things like this, have advanced as well as using photovoltaics to run any pumping that you need in your system so that you are completely solar. But I've done service work throughout southern New England with hundreds of systems, and I can tell you that 95% of the people are happy and confident with those systems.
We'll be back with Richard Gottlieb and Jim Newberry right after this.
This is a little halogen lamp, which is running directly off this photovoltaic panel. Yeah, this is a Kyocera 50-watt panel. This is a 50-watt light bulb. Now, to show you that we're not fooling, that we're not trying to pull anything over, if I turn the solar panel away from the light, from the sun, it dims. And if I bring it back towards the sun, it brightens up. The more it's facing towards the sun, the more power it puts out, and the brighter it lights the lamp.
Since 1974, Plenty International has been a valuable tool for people who want to lend a hand, but in ways that are effective, respectful, and appropriate. Much needs to be done, like installing running water for Mayan villages in the highlands of Guatemala, helping Native Americans develop home gardens, and working for the improved nutrition of children in Nicaragua. Plenty fields volunteers from all walks of life, recognizes the interdependence of all living things and works to promote economic fair play, cultural diversity, and a livable environment. If we put our minds, hearts, and hands together, we can do what needs to be done. For more information, please write Plenty, P.O. Box 2306, Davis, California, 95617, or call 916-753-0731.
Please, I think I'm dying. Please, someone, please, help me.
Back with Enviro Close-Up and Why Not Solar Now. Richard Gottlieb, you've run for the governorship of the state of Vermont, the great state of Vermont, under the banner since 1980, under the banner of the Liberty Union Party. So you're somebody who understands government, Richard. The government has been promoting nuclear technology ever since the 1940s to the tune of hundreds of billions of dollars in terms of subsidy, forgetting about the Price-Anderson Act, which limits the liability in the event of a nuclear plant accident. What could the government, what should the government do to do something about making sure that solar is widely deployed, Richard?
Well, the government, particularly in Vermont and in Massachusetts too, could begin to utilize solar energy in all of its buildings. If you go to a place like Australia, it's mandatory that the government buildings all have solar hot water and some photovoltaic installations. In Vermont, there are some installations on government buildings. Some of these are defunct, some of them half work. If the government made some effort to utilize cost-effective technologies like solar hot water and photovoltaics, that would show the people in Vermont that these things are worthwhile doing, and it would be a way of promoting it. The state of Vermont, for example, has already installed, as the state of Massachusetts has, some electric vehicle charging stations. They did one at in Waterbury, very similar to what's done here at Alewife Station in Massachusetts. They put photovoltaics on the building to provide electricity to the grid, and that electricity is used to charge electric vehicles. That's just one of the many things that could be done. The other part of it, I think, the main thing that needs to be done is energy conservation. You go into government buildings, and there are nothing but incandescent lights and lack of insulation and waste everywhere. As governor, that's the first thing I would chase after. That's the most cost-effective thing to do. And after that, we do the solar and the more jazzy things like photovoltaics.
Now, Jim, government is not some sort of obscure foreign entity. I mean, government is there because we put it there. What do you think people can do to get government to do perhaps some of the things that Richard suggests and perhaps more?
Well, I guess it comes down to using our political system and acting like we're a democracy here, where we start getting involved in these decisions, these very important decisions that our local, state, and federal government are making. So it's the age-old encouragement to write those senators, and hopefully they'll hear our voices. Of course, we need to be aware that they are also hearing voices that are very powerful from the other side, the lobbying that the conventional energy sources are going to do to continue the status quo, if you will.
Now, just if we could, Jim, if you can give the address and the number of EarthStar Energy Systems, so if people want more information from you, they could get it, and Richard, you the same.
Happy to. EarthStar is at, we have a post office box, 626. Our shipping address is Route 220 at US 1 in Waldoboro, Maine. Zip code is 04572.
And the 800 number?
In Maine, it's 660-6749. And in the United States, it's 323-6749.
Maine's in the United States, too, though I think a lot of Downeasterners in Maine may not agree with that. And Richard, where can people get in touch with Sunnyside?
Sunnyside is available by phone and fax. We're at RD4, Box 808 in Brattleboro, Vermont, 05301. Our phone is 802-257-1482, and the fax is 257-254-4670.
Terrific, and thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
The costs are something that are important that need to come down. And also the huge solar panels that we need for collecting the energy need to somehow be compacted in size. So I think the technology is in a growth phase, and at some point in the future it'll be ready for mainstream.
skies are blue and clouds are white. The bright, blessed day, the dogs say good night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
If you're not recycling, you're throwing it all away.
The dump site we're proposing is perfectly safe, trust me.
The people who tell you that nuclear waste dumps are safe are stretching the truth. Trucks carrying radioactive waste will be traveling through our neighborhoods, so no area is safe.
As for our track record, accidents will happen.
You're alive.
Clean it up.
Nuclear waste. The problem is bigger than you think.
We're back with Enviro Close-Up and the issue, why not solar now? And with us now is Eric Karplus. He's with the Full Circle Energy Project based in East Falmouth, Massachusetts. Eric, why not solar now?
Well, Carl, I think there's a couple things that I can tell you about the fact that we can choose solar now. It's out there. There's people like the two folks we just spoke with, Jim Newberry and Richard Gottlieb, who are providing solar now. And in fact, it's a cost-effective option for a lot of people. In fact, anybody who has an electric hot water heater in the United States of America, no matter where you are, has the option to choose an solar-assisted hot water heating system that they can put on their roof, finance through a bank even, and still be paying the same amount or less for their hot water as they're paying right now. In addition to that, they'll also be avoiding having to consume electricity that's produced by either fossil fuels or nuclear electric power. And one of the things that the industry needs to focus on is going out and getting those customers to choose solar. So there's a tremendous opportunity for the industry right now to go out and market and ask for sales from people who really do have a benefit, an economic benefit from solar domestic hot water heating systems available to them right now. There's also people who aren't close to the utility grid right now who can take advantage of photovoltaics. The cost of extending utility grid line to a home can be quite high, and the cost of installing a photovoltaic system in your home may be significantly less than that. So this is an issue that people who are developing communities, people who are town planners, people who are state planners, people who are federal planners of development, also people who are in utility planning, can really take advantage of the opportunities that solar has to offer us today. We've spent quite a few years developing these technologies, and we have tremendous opportunity to invest more money now and go further than we've already gone. And that's very exciting that we really do have something to work with now that is cost effective. And telecommunications is another industry where they're putting up remote radio towers that need power to transmit communications. And as we know, communications are really the wave of the future for people to be able to work from their home office instead of having to commute. So there's some really tremendous opportunities in the marketplace already. But this is just the beginning. There's quite a few other things we can do. And this is something that the government can play a role in, something that the utility industry can play a role in, and also businesses. We're going to see quite a few things change in the utility industry in the next few years, and one of them is going to be deregulation. But there's also some tremendous opportunities, even in, for instance, the state of Massachusetts and other states throughout the union, you can sell power that you generate at your house back to the utility, and they are required by law to purchase it back from you at retail cost. It's called net metering. And so if you install a system on your house, you can have a utility bill of zero if you produced as much power and sold it back to the grid as you consumed from the grid. So already we have these opportunities to use solar technologies that have already been developed, are reliable, and are cost effective. And what the industry needs to be doing is going out and seeking customers to take advantage of these technologies. And it's tremendous to be able to work with the media to share that knowledge with people. And it's very important also to have places where people can get information and link up with a distributor and installer to get the product from the manufacturer out into the marketplace. And that's one of the real things that's changing in our economy. We have the capability to do almost whatever we like. And that's one of the things that the government can take the advantage of to pour the money into pushing the technology along, but also We have a real, the real power to develop anything we like, but the real challenge is to distribute what we have developed to people who can take advantage of it. And this is something where the power of distribution is really going to determine the future of the solar industry. And I think there are excellent opportunities for us to be taking advantage of those things. Another issue that we need to address is really absorbing and reflecting the real cost of other fuels. Right now, most of our energy in this country comes from coal. oil, and natural gas, and we import over half of our oil. And these are finite resources, and we're using more and more of them every year. And we need to pay attention to that. Even though the federal government tells us we have so many years left at current levels of consumption, we're consuming more and more each year. And the real reality of exponential growth against a finite source is a reality that we're going to have to face. And the people who are going to face it are the planners and the developers who are really defining how our communities work today. And what they're going to be looking for is resources that we can take advantage of on a regular basis without having to go and use tremendous amounts of land to mine those resources and having to develop really centralized, huge facilities where we have to ship all these fuel resources in and then produce power and pump it out over a utility grid. We're really going to see a role for these new technologies where we have distributed systems that are collecting energy from our environment, energy from the sun that reaches the planet Earth every day is producing. The Earth intercepts over 5 million quadrillion BTUs from the sun every year. That's a tremendous amount of energy. The whole population on the planet used under 350 quadrillion BTUs, which is several orders of magnitude lower than the amount of energy available for the sun. So those energy resources are coming to us every day, and we have the technological capabilities to capture that energy and use it to build the kind of lifestyles that we really want to experience as human beings and really do it in harmony with the environment. And that's the kind of thing that people have to have the vision for in the federal government of the United States. We need to accept that that is doable, and then we need to go out and promote everything we can that will achieve that vision of real harmony with the energy resources that are really out there for us. The amount of energy that comes to us from the sun is much greater than any other resource we have right now. That if we could mine all the petroleum out of the planet Earth and burn it all at once, we still wouldn't be able to match the amount of energy available to us from the sun. So we need to be creative in addressing that need. We also need to cultivate a friendship among the industry and the legislature and the media so that people are really sharing the knowledge that we have and taking advantage of it. And this gets back to the issue of distribution. How do we educate people about what's available to them? Because in fact, there are many opportunities. And if you own an electric powered hot water heater, you should really try to find out about who is installing solar technologies in your community, because they can put a solar domestic hot water system on your roof and you can end up paying less for your energy. And you can also be avoiding the environmental impacts of using energy from fossil fuels or nuclear power plants. And that's a tremendous opportunity.
And we'll be back with Enviro Close Up right after this.
There was a great movement a number of years ago, and there was interest in supporting solar energy. And it was not only not helped, it was hindered by the departments that were supposed to be developing it. And my hope would be that we could develop this the way the country had been interested in a few years ago.
Don't worry, the safety valve is absolutely reliable. There is no need for concern. And anyway, once it's there, we might as well use it. Trust us.
I dreamed all of the animals will be safe forever.
I dreamed our water got clean again.
I would like more trees to grow.
And the ozone layer will get strong again.
Fish are neat and I don't want any of them to die.
I dreamed our Earth will get well again because everyone who lived here started doing things to help it.
Help our planet to get better.
Make every day Earth Day.
It's coming. The most significant event in automotive history. It's coming. the end of the age of the automobile.
Eric, what's the Full Circle Energy Project?
Full Circle Energy Project Incorporated is a 501c3 not-for-profit organization dedicated to bringing sensible energy resources into the mainstream so that everybody in our community, and that's our national community and our global community, can take advantage of sensible energy resources.
And how can people get in touch with you?
Well, we're located in East Falmouth, Massachusetts. We're at 30 Sandwich Road in East Falmouth, Mass., 02536, and our phone number is 508-457-4557, and our fax is 4527. And I have an email address of ekarplus@igc.apc.org. Feel free to send me an email.
With just a few seconds to close, what else could people do besides get involved with the Full Circle Energy Project to get solar now?
Choose it. Find out who's installing solar domestic hot water systems and photovoltaics in your community. Call them up and see what they can do for you. They can do a lot.
And political action?
Write your congressman. Tell them that we need to reflect the true cost of fossil fuels and nuclear power in the price that we pay for them.
Your state government, your local government?
Contact them. Contact your representatives. Write them a letter. Give them a phone call. Tell them that we need to express the true cost of fossil fuels and nuclear power in the bills that we pay. When we pay at the gas pump, when we pay our electric utility bills, when we pay our home heating bills, we're not paying the full cost. The government is subsidizing them with our tax dollars. We need to be paying them on the utility bill.
Indeed, why not solar now? I think it very much depends on you. You've been watching Enviro Close Up. I'm Carl Grossman. Thanks for watching.
As far as the governmental participation in encouraging solar power harnessing, I think a lot was happening at one point, maybe 10 or 15 years ago, and then somehow it got sidelined as an issue. And I think more needs to happen now and bring that to forefront and make more and more people aware of that, and also, you know, put some infusion of funds into academic research.